quite, I get it that quite a few students, especially from IIT, may have this question that, I mean, we'll do a good job. That's enough, right? Why do we, should we even consider getting into the so-called development sector or social sector? Is there even a need? I think the answer is pretty straightforward. I mean, whether you enter the social sector or not is also a personal choice. But I think at a meta level, we definitely need this sector. And why do we need this sector? If we have to kind of conceptually look at it, Peter Drucker, one of the most famous management thinker of the 20th century, beautifully articulated this in his book called Managing the Nonprofit Organization, where he says that the primary purpose of the government is to form rules and policies which kind of govern the society. In India, with our own socialist past, there is a tendency for government to get into almost everything, and which I don't know whether that's a desirable trait or not. I'm not even saying that government shouldn't do anything, but there has to be some check and limit as to what are the areas where government should get in. For example, should government really be running an airline company? Is that even government's job, or is that something left best to the social, to the private sector? So as per Peter Drucker, government's job is to frame rules and policies. Private sector's job is to deliver goods and services which people need, and where the private player can also make some profit so that it is sustainable for him, and to deliver it in the in an ethical fashion, follow excellence in that, so that kind of there is progress. That is private sector's job. Then what is social sector's job? So interestingly, even after the role that the private sector and the government sector does, which oftentimes they don't fulfill to its fullest, there are quite a few gaps and loopholes which remain. And to kind of fill up those, there is a need of the social sector. So Peter Drucker says that both the government and the private sector aren't by default much interested in changing the human being. So he says that the primary nature of the social sector, or the primary impact of social sector, is a changed human being. If I am giving, let's say I run a private school, then most often the transaction is over when a student comes, I take fees from him, I deliver something in return. Or even if you can, actually you can take an example of a Kirana shop where you go and let's say buy a Gillette blade, you take it, your Gillette blade, you give money, the transaction is over. The shop owner has no interest regarding, and is legitimately so, has no interest as to what you go and do with that particular Gillette blade. Whether you used to shave your own, make your own shave, whether you used to cut somebody else's face, or what you do out of it, he has no interest in. Social sector needs to have an interest in changing the human beings, in empowering human beings. Because this is something which both the government and the private sector usually doesn't get into. Also, if you look at most of the last mile situations, today, I must say I'm really fortunate because I'm sitting here in Gadchiroli, which is 1,000 kilometers from IIT Bombay on the easternmost corner of Maharashtra. And luckily today, I have this good quality internet through which I can speak with you. But this did not exist almost 5 years, till 5 years ago. And I'm pretty sure that there are quite a few other places in India where internet came much earlier. And there are still quite a few other places in India where internet is still yet to reach. So the last mile problem in most of the services is a crucial one. Private sector usually doesn't want to go there because that is not profitable enough. Government may want to go there, often tries to do that, but often finds it really difficult to get capable and committed manpower who will sustain over there. So you have a Leelavati in Bombay. You also have a KEM and JJ Hospital in Bombay, but you have something which is absolutely not comparable with this in places like, let's say, Nandurbar, places like, let's say, Gadchiroli, places like, let's say, Yavatmal. So the last mile problem, whether it is about education, whether it is about transport, whether it is about technology, whether it is about healthcare, is usually left out of the purview of government and private sector. So at a meta level, in order to fill all such gaps, I think social sector is extremely needed. So right now, I'm not even talking about an individual Amruts or Pavans or Yatins or somebody else's need in social sector. Right now I'm talking at a meta level, the overall need of the social sector. Another place where we need social sector is, quite often, government, which has bureaucratic and political power, and private sector, which usually has monetary power, usually tend to hold on to power. And we, I mean, I don't need to explain this to all of you. You have seen this in ample quantity all around us. And so when there is misuse of power, there has to be somebody who comes up and acts as a whistleblower that, hey, here is injustice going on. Here, the foundations of our democracy are being shattered. So right now, what is happening with Advocate Prashant Bhushan is, I think, extremely important. And right now, when Prashant Bhushan is fighting that particular struggle in the Supreme Court, he's neither government, he's neither private sector. He's a civil society member, he's a social sector member. So you also need social sector in terms of in the role of a whistleblower. You also need social sector to try out quite a new innovative pilots. Unfortunately, quite often in government, you are constrained by bureaucracy and red tape. In private sector, you are oftentimes constrained by the pressure of quarterly profits. So the kind of freedom and kind of flexibility that a particular agency might need to think about creative and innovative solutions to solve some of community's burning problems, that's a luxury oftentimes not exercised or available to government or private sector. That's also something where we need a social sector. I can go on expanding this list, but just to make the point crisper, at a meta level, our society does need the social sector. Now, the question for all the young people would be, okay, social sector is needed in the society. Am I needed in the social sector? Or will somebody else do the job and I can go and do something else? Obviously, I mean, there is need for good people, definitely in government sector, also in the private sector. But relatively, these two sectors don't seem to be struggling with as severe a shortage as what a social sector is going to struggle with. So I'm pretty sure if you just look at the placement records of IIT Bombay, you see the kind of competition of various top corporate companies have to hire the best of the best talent. So definitely the corporate sector has some or the other means, oftentimes a cushy salary, to attract talent. Government also, you see the kind of long list of people who are waiting to spend 3-4 years writing exams for UPSC and ultimately getting selected. That also shows that government has been fairly successful in attracting people to enter it. Social sector, I would say, A, hasn't been so successful also. So that is something that the social sector needs to reflect upon. And at the same time, it's usually invisible to our eyes. So as a young professional, one of the questions which I asked myself when I was in Symantec, I was in private sector, one of the questions which I asked myself was, where am I needed the most? From the 350 students of my college, everybody applied to Symantec. And from 350, four of us got selected. So obviously, even if I quit my job, Symantec already had three other people from my college, and there were 346 other people who were waiting to get in line. This is just from my college. And there are obviously so many other colleges to get people from. So my presence or absence in the private sector, I thought, didn't make that much of a difference. I was more like a replaceable cog. I was doing a good job, getting paid hefty salary, fine. But probably I'm needed more in some other place. And that was one reason why I quit my job and joined the social sector, one of the reasons. As I said, there is definitely a tremendous need. Whether some of the people in the audience of this particular talk decide to join the social sector, that would depend on what is their reasoning and their rationale for choosing a profession. That's a very valid and very practical question and bugs quite a few people. So 2-3 things which I would like to share regarding this. One is, I was in Symantec from 2007 to 2008. I quit within completing a year. And whatever salary I was receiving then, if I adjust it for inflation, I don't think I am receiving that salary even now. So coming to social sector, I have definitely reduced my salary, that is there. But there is also one interesting feature that I saw about myself and many of my other classmates, and some of you who already worked in corporate sector may agree or disagree with that. So the feature was, till yesterday, we were all perfectly happy when we were in college. We were all perfectly happy drinking a chai on a tapri, which cost 5 rupees. And we also had a samosa, and it was both tasty, and we had no social compulsion to behave in a particular norm. So those chit chats with my friend were much more free and much more joyful. Moment many of us started getting into various corporate jobs, it somehow became uncool to meet at a tapri, and somehow the destination automatically changed to a barista or a CCD. And I personally am not a very big fan of those coffees. Just pure taste wise also, our opinions could vary. But the point that I'm trying to hint is, many of the social norms that we were comfortable following till yesterday somehow automatically changed in society's mind and in also our mind as to what we should now be doing, where we should be hanging out, what kind of clothes should we be wearing, what kind of artifacts should we be expending on. Moment we got a job, this seemed to change. And then the changed norms kind of tend to justify our salary, and then kind of making it compulsory for us that you have to live in this particular kind of a lifestyle, and that's why you need this much kind of a money. So we have to be aware of that kind of a shift. If you voluntarily choose that, and if that is the kind of lifestyle you want, fair enough, go ahead, have that salary. But I personally didn't think that it was really necessary, and that shouldn't be a criteria for me to shirk away from the thought of engaging in social sector. So that is part one. Part two was this whole thing of getting salary in the corporate sector. So I'll give you a very real example, what happened with me. So yes, there was very good salary in Semantic, very hefty salary. And I'm pretty sure that many of you are going to earn even much bigger packages than that. What happens when we get a salary? What is ultimately a salary? So what happened in my case, I will tell you. Whatever my first salary was in Semantic, even till date, whatever my monthly amount was, even till date, I haven't seen that much amount physically together at one go. उतना पैसा मैंने एक जगह पे आज तक कभी देखा ही नहीं है, क्योंकि उतना पैसा एक झटके में मैंने आज तक कभी खर्च ही नहीं किया है. So what did that salary mean? That salary basically meant that at every month end, I used to get a message from HDFC Bank saying this and this much amount got credited to your account. The amount kept on increasing, the total amount in the bank. I never expended money more than the incoming rate. So I thought that if I kind of program myself into getting messages which keep telling that at the end of this month, this much salary has been credited into your account, it was completely a psychological game for me. I had never seen that much salary together. I had never even expended it. So what do I do with it? So, I mean, before we get into the fact of whether social sector is financially viable or not, we have to also think about this fact that the kind of salary levels that we get, do we really need those many salaries? So we have to do that kind of an exercise. Oftentimes during our Nirman interviews, we also ask our applicants to do this exercise, that assuming you want to live a comfortable life, how much money do you think you will need on a monthly basis to make it happen? And people don't have an answer. Then people just give away any random figure from the top of their mind, but we actually make them write it in specifics, make an Excel sheet. On left-hand column, make each and every item, right-hand column, actually put amounts, and then you see what happens. So the one thing is, I personally didn't require that much amount. It was purely a psychological game. So I decided that I cannot allow this kind of a psychological game to decide my life choices. So that was question number one. Point number one. Point number two was, I think that there can be no argument about the fact that all of us should contribute to making the world a better place, because the inverse makes no sense. So I don't think any of us can actually even question this thing that we should try to make the world a better place. So that is like one given. Even if you don't enter the social sector, even if you are in government sector, even if you are in private sector, let's try and do something which makes the world a better place. Even if I am creating a product, let's try and create a beautiful product. Let's try and create it in as much cost effectiveness as possible. Even that is contributing to making the world a better place. Social sector is more direct and more active in its approach. That's the difference. But I don't think we can argue with the fact that all of us need to contribute to making the world a better place. So that's one given. Now, the second given is also this reality that we all need money to sustain ourselves, fulfill some of our family needs, also make some savings for the future. So I think if we look at this problem in a more engineering sense, or in, from an engineering perspective, I think rather than putting them one after the other, or rather than putting them one against the other, can we look at this as sort of solving a simultaneous equation? So I need to be able to solve this equation simultaneously. I need to be able to contribute to the world so as to make it better. I also need to earn enough for me to survive. Can I do this simultaneously? And I think there are going to be lots and lots of permutations and combinations, as there are quite a few solutions to one simultaneous equation. There are going to be quite a few solutions to this equation as well, where you might kind of move on a pendulum of how much time you can contribute to social action and how much money you are going to get or lose as a result of it. I think some of us have hit a sweet spot where we can contribute full time to social action and at the same time get salary through social action, which is more than enough than what our monthly needs are. So for some people, the sweet spot may come in this case, where you can devote full time and also get salary. Social sector also offers salary. So you can do it in that way together. For some people, it would be like, okay, probably I need to do a job maybe 3 weeks a month or whatever, 10 months a year, or maybe have a different kind of a time commitment chalked out. Or maybe I'll do it for 10 years and then I'll have enough and then I can engage in social sector, or I'll volunteer on weekends, or I'll do something else. So people can answer the simultaneous equation in a variety of ways. But I think the beauty lies in not putting these two things against each other. We have to solve for both of them. Okay. I was lucky enough to solve it in a way which allowed me to do what I'm doing today. Yeah, so an obvious time constraint, which obvious thing is a time constraint, which is like a no-brainer, or a location constraint. So if I'm working in, let's say, New York, I'm working in Bombay, and if I say that I want to contribute to welfare of people in Nandurbar, I'm just making up examples over here. It is not impossible, and people have done it, but it is slightly more difficult. I mean, you physically being there where your target population is makes a huge difference. So that is definitely one. A more serious thing I think we need to check is whether my work in the corporate or government sector, is it at crossroads with what I would have done in if I would have been in the social sector? So let's say, should a brilliant IIT, and let's say somebody who is from an IIT and who is brilliant in marketing, and let's say an alcohol company or a tobacco company hires him as a marketing executive. He obviously gets paid a lot, and the company makes a huge deal of profit at the cost of health of so many other people. And this guy may also say that, okay, I'll do this job, and then I'll also volunteer at the month end at a charity or at a social sector organization or an orphanage or maybe a de-addiction facility. And while I would appreciate him doing that than doing nothing, I think there is this obvious moral question that if my actions are causing active harm in one domain of life, can I just make up for it by doing something else in another domain of life? And forget what others are going to think about it. I think this is more important a question for my own moral self-belief and my own moral stand. So I think before thinking about how I can simultaneously contribute to social action, first we should kind of have clarity about whether my actions in the private sector, are they causing any active harm to social order? If that is the case, there is need to rethink much more seriously. If that is not the case, suppose we're doing something that is not causing any active harm, is like any other product, Surf Excel bana rahe hain, bol do, ya aur kuch bhi aur bana rahe hain, koi financial market mein derivative bana rahe hain, whatever XYZ could be there. So in that case, if there is no active harm, then I have got this choice, that sweet spot on the simultaneous equation. I could keep on doing my job and contribute parallelly, or I could also say that, hey, let me go and engage more seriously, more vigorously with social actions. The obvious time constraint is going to be there. Another constraint is going to be there, which is, do I really understand my target audience? So let's say if I'm in Bombay and I really feel for the malnourishment of tribal children in Nandurbar, and I really want to help solve it. Very good. But then the obvious question would be, it's like solving any engineering problem. I need to understand the problem. I need to understand the customer. I need to understand what is their present life like. What are the constraints under which they are operating? What kind of a solution would be effective? What have others tried in the past? What works? What doesn't work? What is going to be cost effective? Unless I do all of this, my engagement in social action is not going to be effective. So I think I oftentimes see this unfortunate trend where people approach their usual career with a sense of rationality and hard logic, which is great. But when it comes to social action, oftentimes it is only sentimentality. And I personally don't like this kind of division. I think social action also merits rational thought, rigorous thought, scientific thought. And like we would go solving any aerospace problem, we should also bring the same kind of rigor into solving the problem of malnourishment or education or transport or internet or whatever else, or water. So inability to understand the target audience deeply is going to be a serious constraint. So time constraint and this understanding constraint, these two come to my mind most profoundly. See, there are quite a few interesting thoughts on this. One thing is about status. I've also heard this criticism myself, and I've also seen happen with quite a few other people that, are engineering chhod diya, ye kuch alag hi kaam kar rahe ho. But I mean, if you quit, I mean, leave the path of computer engineering or electronics engineering or aerospace engineering and go into solving the social problem, people say, kya tumne engineering chhod diya. But the most coveted placement at IIT Bombay is Goldman Sachs. People forget that. Nobody asks that guy, kare engineering chhod diya, ab to tum finance market mein chale gaye. So this thought coming from people in my mind doesn't make any sense. Engineering is ultimately problem solving. Any good engineering college gives us skills. It most often doesn't tell us which problems and whose problems. We have to use the engineering skill set of given to us by IIT Bombay or any other institute that we are from, and then through our own rational inquiry, choose which problem and whose problems do I need to apply my engineering mindset to solve those problems. So that is part one. About this whole status thing, I mean, I get what you are saying, but I mean, my honest submission is that at least this question should not bother people from IIT. I mean, in the field of technical domain, you have done the best, at least in terms of education, you have done the best that is possible in this country. Ab tum logon ko bhi yahi tension hone lagi ki to baki pure log kidhar jayenge. So I think you guys need to show the guts that we don't have to keep proving ourselves each and every day. And we were capable enough, intelligent enough to get into IIT, we have learned some of the best skills. And yes, it is our rational thought that we want to make use of these skills for wider benefit. And if that takes you to villages, if that takes you to slums, if that takes you to difficult areas, what's the problem? Yatin here on this call worked for 3 years in Narayanpur in Chhattisgarh, which is like a tribal belt, quite often bordered by Naxalite activities. And I think that should be something which we all should be proud of, rather than feeling that arey udhar kai ko gaya. So that self-esteem and self-confidence, I think, is very much necessary, and we need to show that. Just to add to this question, Pawan, I am seeing a question typed in the chat box by Yatin, which says, does social sector also come up with some lifestyle and dressing norms? And I think that's a very valid question, because I think that's one of the big misconceptions that has been propagated about social sector. Ki ye to jhola wale log hain, baki kuch bhi nahi karte hain, wagera wagera. That might be true 30 years back. Today, I don't think that is a norm. I don't even think that the salary scales in social sector force you to live a simpler life. You can do it by choice. देर इज एम्पल मनी इन सोशल सेक्टर, बट स्टिल यू मे से कि नहीं मुझे सिंपल लाइफ जीनी है, खामा का फालतू के खर्च क्यों करूँ, तो दैट इज अ चॉइस. बट आई डोंट थिंक इट कम्स विद एनी काइंड ऑफ a particular norm. Here I am sitting in front of you, I personally think I'm wearing a nice shirt, I have a Titan watch in my hand, and I wear a hush puppy, and all of this is pretty much possible. So I don't think there are any such norms, and if at all there are norms, we as young people and as confident engineers need to crack those norms and set the right norms in motion. A great question. Quite a few people struggle with that. I completely agree with you that skill is necessary. And in 21st century, we are going to need quite a different and new skill sets to solve the problems of this century. So no doubt or no two thoughts about learning good skills. Now, the way you presented the question was more in a dichotomous fashion. So I would say that we have to think about a couple of points about it. One is, because we're in 21st century, which is like a knowledge century, you have to continuously keep learning. So aisa artificial division mat karo man mein ki pehle puri padhai kar lunga fir kaam karunga. Iska matlab kya, kaam karna chalu karoge to padhai nahi karoge, ya fir kaam karunga padhai baad mein kabhi dekh lenge. So I think formal learning through degrees is a very useful and one form of learning which we should do if it is necessary. But we have to master the habit of continuously keep on doing self-learning. And sometimes you could also go for workshops. Sometimes you could also go for certain conferences, whatever XYZ. Sometimes you may just go and shadow a few people, maybe go for exposure visit. These are also important forms of learning. Online courses we have. So learning to continuous chalne wali cheez honi chahiye. Hum aisa bol hi nahi sakte ki main learning ko khatam kar dunga. Now the question is, formal learning karke jo so called degree based learning hai wo karke aaye hain ki uske bina aaye, I think it's also partly your own nature and the kind of skill set that you have. Just today morning we were working on our Nirman database. There are 1419 participants in Nirman till date, so we have a database and we were creating some entries in that. So I was just going through the kind of the level of education that our participants have taken. And in these 1419 people, there are only 10 people who have studied only till HSC. Rest all are either bachelors or masters or people like Yatin who are pursuing PhD or have done PhD. So, but there are 10 people who have done only HSC, and two out of those 10 are some of the most stellar Nirmanis. Two out of those 10 are those Nirmanis who have done some remarkable work. So although they're only educated till HSC, I would say they are probably more effective than many of the others like us who are probably more educated. So education can be a good tool, but A, it is not always a necessity. But probably if you have this question in mind, that means probably it's a necessity for you, because those two, Devaji and Sharad, whom I just mentioned, probably didn't struggle with this question. So one thing is we need to kind of allow for this flexibility that there might be a different kind of a path for different people. The other aspect is that skill building is definitely necessary. But nowadays, the skills that are needed to solve a specific problem are going to be defined, or the requirements are going to change from which problem do you choose to solve. So let's say if I want to play cricket, but I do practice of playing basketball, is it going to help? The question is, yes. The answer is yes, up to a limit. Because even by doing basketball, you develop some sort of an athleticism, you develop certain muscles, you develop concentration and all of that. So even by playing basketball, you are going to develop skill set up to a limit, which is going to be transferable when you join cricket. But then there are going to be certain skills which you're only going to learn and only going to need and only going to realize that you need when you actually start playing cricket. So many of the skills that we learn from many of the degrees are usually those transferable skills. So if you can learn few transferable skills and bring them to any or the other problem that you are solving, great. But then eventually you will have to narrow down on the particular problem that you want to solve. And in the context of that problem, then it makes more sense to now go out in the world, look for the best possible learning resources, and then make yourself more capable. So I think this mental shift is needed, that A, there is not going to be a set path for everyone. B, we have to keep on doing continuous learning. We cannot just say that my learning phase is over now. That will make you obsolete very soon. And C, basketball can only take you up to a certain limit. वहाँ तक जरूर जाओ, उस transferable skill का पूरा इस्तेमाल कर लो. But beyond that, you have to learn skills which are specific to cricket if your goal is to play cricket. So the question is, how do I find out whether I want to play cricket or not? हम वो question को postpone करते रहते हैं. And then we go on playing basketball, basketball, basketball. फिर कोई तो भी बीच में आके बोलते हैं, यार आजकल टेनिस भी खेलना अच्छा है, थोड़ा टेनिस भी खेल ले और तेरे चार मसल बिल्ड हो जाएंगे. Fine. वो भी अच्छा ही है, कोई बुरी बात नहीं है. But am I going to ultimately actually need them? So one can definitely go like this and should go like this up to a certain level. But then it might also make sense to do reverse engineering. कि कहाँ पे पहुँचना है, कौन से problem को solve करना है. And today I am here, I need to reach here to solve that problem. How can I bridge this learning and competency gap? That might make the learning process more directed. So I think depending on the situation and stage of life that you are at, you can decide whether you want to go from step A to step B, or you want to think about step B and then kind of back to it. So these are some of my thoughts.
Yeah. Yes. We have two questions from chat. First, we will take that. One is from Gopal. He said, like, do you think there is a lack of professionalism to solve social problems? If yes, how to overcome these things?
Great question. I would say there are examples. There are examples of some of the highest quality professionalism and rigor that has been brought to social sector. And there are also examples where there has been fudging, there has been incompetence, there has been hypocrisy in the social sector. And unfortunately, that seems to be like a running thread across all the disciplines. So even in private sector, we see it, even in government sector, we see it. Social sector is also not free from the corrupting influence of shortcuts. But as a norm, I think all of us should certainly strive to bring in more professionalism. And I think it starts with asking basic questions. I mean, usually if you look at, let's say, I mean, this group is much more senior and much more mature, but even if you look at people, young people in, let's say, their 11th and 12th or first year, second or third year of engineering, there are quite a few young people in all of these settings who want to contribute to society. And there are some pet ways that they would go about. So like tree plantation karenge, blood donation camp organize karenge, koi orphanage mein ya slum mein jaake bachchon ko padhayenge. And I really appreciate the desire. And as I say, it is much better to do this rather than doing nothing. But agar abhi humne ye karna chalu kar diya hai, so can we also ask questions? Can we also ask questions like, okay, maine blood donation college mein kar diya, 20 logon ne 20 bottle blood de diya, gaadi blood leke chali gayi, sab ho gaya, chalo khush ho jate hain. Yahan pe rukenge ya ye bhi bolenge ki blood actually bahar kahan pe gaya? Did it reach the intended audience? Was it sold at an unfair price? How was it stored? What is the actual need? Bombay ki need agar 2000 bottle hai और हमने 200 बोतल ब्लड दिया तो भी अच्छा ही है, नथिंग रॉन्ग. बट देन वी शुड ऑल्सो थिंक अबाउट, अच्छा 2000 बोतल अगर दिन की जरूरत है, सो इज देयर समथिंग वी कैन डू बाय विच वी कैन एक्चुअली क्रिएट अ सप्लाई ऑफ 2000 बोतल. सो दीज आर लाइक सिंपल इंजीनियरिंग क्वेश्चंस. इफ यू स्टार्ट आस्किंग देम, आई थिंक इट विल ऑटोमेटिकली फोर्स अस टू बी मोर प्रोफेशनल. देयर इज ऑल्सो अ टेंडेंसी विच आई सी क्वाइट ऑफन दीज डेज, विच इज टू डिक्लेयर सक्सेस वेरी अर्ली. And even though people might get out of or reduce the influence of money or security to some extent and may venture into social sector, the strong desire to be successful or to be claimed or portrayed as a successful person or as a successful model is so much that oftentimes people border on hypocrisy or people border on making claims that are not well substantiated by data. And I think it's a very risky very risky tradition. And I also see a lot of that in the social sector. So I think we must be very careful about that. Whenever anybody makes claims, we should ask this question, basis kya hai, aadhar kya hai, kaise dikhaya? Even when we make our own claims, we should try to look at what is the data on the basis of which we are making this claim, what is the validity data. So ye jo hum kisi bhi achhe engineering process karenge, if we start applying some of those norms here, I think that would be first step to bringing in professionalization.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Abhinav, please.
Yeah. So we'll be taking two more questions from Abhishek and Ankur, and then we'll continue with the Pavan's questions. So Abhishek has asked a question. He says that, did you notice any difference in attitudes of people in corporate sector and the development sector? Like most of his friends in corporate often complain that they are not satisfied and seem less motivated.
Yeah, absolutely. Bang on target. I definitely sensed that difference. That was also one of my major reasons why I quit the corporate sector and joined the social sector. I mean, I'm pretty sure you'll also find really motivated people in the corporate and private sector also, if you are lucky enough to get close to them. I wasn't that lucky, I must say that. But jo Symantec ke mere colleagues the, wo jis enthusiasm ke saath wo week spend kiya karte the, and the desperation with which they used to wait for weekends and to do the same routine fun activities for weekends was really not so cool, not so motivating at all. And I must say that when I entered the social sector, and even till today, I consider myself extremely fortunate and privileged to have witnessed and met some of the people who are incredible. I mean, unko dekh ke kai baar aisa feel aata hai ki yaar jaane do mere personal career, mere personal ambition ko kya chipak ke baithi ho. ऐसा कोई बंदा मिल गया है, इनके साथ खुद की नैया बहा दो. सो माय पर्सनल असेसमेंट हैज बीन दैट मोस्ट ऑफ अस आर ऑर्डिनरी पीपल. वी माइट बी इंटेलिजेंट बट वी आर स्टिल ऑर्डिनरी इन वेरियस अदर वॉक्स ऑफ लाइफ, स्पेशली द मॉरल डोमेन ऑफ लाइफ. एंड व्हेन वी सी सर्टेन एग्जांपल्स, इट इज सच एन एलिवेटिंग थिंग. व्हेन आई गॉट टू मीट माय मेंटर मिस्टर विवेक सावंत, व्हेन आई गॉट टू मीट द फेमस एग्रीकल्चरल एक्टिविस्ट मिस्टर विजय जावंदिया, or when I got to meet the waterman, Mr. Dr. Rajendra Singh, when I had gone to Bangladesh and met Dr. Zafrullah Chowdhury, the lawyer of Bangladesh. Itne incredibly inspiring people hai. And against all odds, inhone jis tarike ka kaam kiya, ya phir, we were fortunate that Dr. Richard Cash, the inventor of oral rehydration therapy, had visited us for one of our Nirman workshops. Kamal ka kaam kiya in logon ne. To inki personality ko dekh ke, और इनके जीवन की जो पूरी गतिविधि है उसको देख के एटलीस्ट आई फेल्ट दैट आई वॉन्ट टू लिव इन द कंपनी ऑफ सच पीपल. आई वॉन्ट टू स्पेंड माई डे ट्राइंग टू फॉलो एंड ट्राइंग टू हेल्प सॉल्व सम ऑफ द क्वेश्चंस दैट दीज पीपल आर सॉल्विंग. आई वॉन्ट टू बी अ लॉयल सोल्जर टू दीज कर्नल्स इन दीज मेजर्स. सो आई थिंक इट हैड अ टू प्रॉन्ग्ड इफेक्ट ऑन मी. वन इफेक्ट वॉज दैट इट गेव मी ट्रेमेंडस इंस्पिरेशन एंड मोटिवेशन to work, and so the days are not derailing or draining at all. And even right now it's 6:20 and my day today began at 6:15 in the morning, and I have been working since then. I'm still feeling pretty fresh, and I think you can also see it from my face. I don't have to fake it. And so every day becomes kind of really exciting. Chutti aur kaam ye bhed kafi had tak dur ho gaya mere man mein, so at least so that was one effect. The other effect which was there, and I would say which was more deep, was that meeting such people and kind of aligning my own life journey with them freed me of my own personal ambitions and my own personal anxieties. This is a big statement to make, and I must confess that I have not arrived as yet, and quite often the ambition and the insecurities do creep in. But if I compare myself to how I was in 2007 or 2006, the kind of only motivated by personal ambition and then the accompanied anxiety, which would anyway inherently come with it, my today's life is bliss, I must say. So I also had this internal personal effect of letting go of my insecurities and aligning with such people. So for me, it has been incredible. And whether in social sector or private sector or government sector, I would really urge and request that each and pray that each one of us gets some set of such people, some set of such mentors who can make our life really elevated. Great question. So I think we can answer this question in two ways. One is a more direct utilization of those skills that you have earned in the past. And one is which is slightly more abstract utilization. I think I am more in the abstract utilization domain, but there can also be a direct utilization. And I'll explain what do I mean by both of them. So one thing is, obviously, there are great tools and great techniques in computer science and electronics. And I think there is a very urgent need to bring some of those techniques and tools even to social sector. So jo koi bhi tarike ka programming agar aap seekhe hoge, jo koi bhi tarike ke alag alag, maybe you are good at creating artificial intelligent systems, maybe you are good at programming an IBM Watson based system, kai sare social issues hain jahan pe hum inka bhi istemal kar sakte hain. And I'll just throw a random example. Don't take it, I haven't given hell lot of thought to it, but if you find some merit in it, please go ahead. All of us have experienced this, that on Facebook or on Amazon, when we do a particular kind of a purchase or do even particular kind of search, the system starts throwing preferences which are similar to that. So they are somehow kind of getting some feel of where we are and predicting what we would do next. IBM Watson based system, which are doing some sort of predictions, are already there in the market now, at least in the corporate sector. Now, a complete shift. From 1995 to 2015, in the 20 years, there have been more than 3 lakh farmer suicide in this country, which is a bad thing, all of us would agree upon. Is there a way we can use artificial intelligence or the predictive power of it to somehow predict who is at the highest risk of going and committing suicide? 3 lakh suicides, very bad. The brighter sides, there are so many, such a large number of farmers. So from whatever XYZ, 30 crore farmers, if 3 lakhs committed suicide, so many others didn't. And quite a few of them also were subjected to similar constraints and similar bad things. Yet only few crossed that threshold and went beyond and actually committed suicide. Now, a mental health professional will approach this from a very typical service perspective. Ki chalo hum counseling karte hain, chalo jinke ghar suicide ho gaya unke ghar ka jaake counseling karte hain, ya fir mental health clinic khol dete hain, wahan pe jo log aayenge unka counseling kar dete hain, wagera wagera. Very good. But even mental health professionals have no way by which they can target or fine tune their search window of who are those who are most vulnerable. I'm also pretty sure that although not in such a huge quantity, but there have been sad instances of suicides, even in IIT campuses, at AIIMS campuses, so many other engineering college campuses. We have no way of predicting those. Can your learning from computer engineering be brought in that? This is just a wild thought, but the point that I want to mention is, we can make use of some of the direct skills that we have acquired in our earlier professional life, and bring that kind of a skill set to social sector and maybe create something which the traditional social sector people are unable to think of. So yes, please try and see if you can make such a direct use. Now the other aspect where I would put myself, that I don't do any coding nowadays. I think I haven't done coding for the last 10 years. So that is definitely a direct skill which I had and had it to a pretty good extent, which I'm not using. But I would also say that 4 years of computer engineering didn't teach me just coding. They taught me how to formulate a problem. They taught me how to break down a problem. When I do coding, what is coding? Coding is basically a computer linguistic manifestation of a rational thought process. So, bhale code na karu, par kisi cheez ko code karna hai, matlab aapko pehle brain mein usko rationally step by step todna aana chahiye. So how to do that, I think that mental muscle training did take place in computer engineering. And today I may not be using actual coding, but I think I'm using those same mental muscles which were built during that process in doing the work that I do today. So our engineering also teaches us a lot of other abstract skills. Some of them also being that I'm pretty sure you are also are very familiar with is how to meet deadlines, how to make things work. So there are quite a few of these skills, the abstract skills, and I am perfectly happy using those. Their expression may not come in the form of coding. It might come in the form of something else. It might come in the form of how I might prepare my budget, how I might prepare my project plan, how we go about analyzing financial situation, how we might go about analyzing human resources. So there are a variety of ways by which I can still use the abstract training. So I think it's up to you whether you want to use the direct skills. If you can, great, please go ahead and do it. Social sector needs it to quite an extent. And even if you can't use it, at least I decided not to worry so much about it and cash on the abstract skills. So great question, quite often gets asked. Before I give my answer, I must say that we need the government sector in society. It is going to be there whether we like it or not. And by government, I suppose you are not saying the political structure, more the bureaucratic structure where many of the IITs are also going, I guess. So uski bhi jarurat hai aur wahan pe jaake bhi achha kaam koi kar sakta hai, karna chahiye. Now, why I did not make that choice? So some of my observations and some of my philosophy, I would say, kind of tended me to move away from it. So the observations and philosophy, what were those? So one of my observations is that government most often is status quoist. So transformational kaam karna, ye government ke dimag mein nahi aata hai. Transactional kaam karna aata hai. So the famous joke, if operation successful but patient died. You can see that kind of a thing with many of the government programs and government schemes. That bureaucratic tick marks are there, but ultimate outcome aaya ki nahi. Ye often log dekhte nahi hai. And the part which I spoke in the initial conversation, what Peter Drucker is saying, that government's primary role is to make rules and policies and make people stick to it. It is the social sector's job to see, can we change human beings? So human being ka change hona, uske andar badlav hona, uske andar empowerment hona, ye transformational kaam hai. Usually, barring few gentle exceptions, usually ye government sector ke dhyan mein bhi nahi aata hai. And the government machinery in general, it's pretty much opposed or pretty much difficult to get this thing through. Remember last time you had gone to any government office, whether it's a tahsildar's office or a PWD ka office or a PDS ka office, and how did you feel? Was it really motivating? Were there only transactions getting completed, or were there some kind of a transformation taking place? So my observation was ki yahan pe transformational kaam bahut nahi hota hai, mujhe wo karna tha. Kisi ko agar koi dusra karna hai to bilkul zarur wo jaye, par mujhe ek to wo nahi utna bhaya. And the other thing was that in terms of my own philosophy, I would say that I am a disciple of Vinoba. In this respect, not in all the respects, but Vinoba, whom we know as Mahatma Gandhi's right hand, has written a beautiful book called Lok Niti. So wo kehte hain ki hamare samaj mein kis tarike ka power balance kaise hona chahiye. So Vinoba ka kehna hai ki lok niti hona chahiye, ki power should be closer and closer to people. And it should be, as far as possible, naitik power honi chahiye. To lok niti. To mujhe aisa laga that government, even if it has good intentions, oftentimes tends to hold on to power. So usually hamara jawab kya hota hai? Wo ek minister, ya wo ek koi officer, ya wo ek koi particular position pe jo hai, wo achha kaam nahi kar raha hai. Uske jagah pe main jaunga, to as if things would change. So this is a replacement theory of creating change. Par mere pehle bhi wahan pe koi na koi to baitha hi hai, uske pehle bhi koi na koi to baitha hi tha, fir transformation ya change hua kyun nahi abhi tak? So government's ability to bring about change, I personally think is quite overrated, although there is some merit to it. So I'm not saying that it is zero, but I personally think that it is quite overrated. 1947 se leke aaj tak, there have been officers, there have been ministers, there have been tahsildar, there have been everybody. तो आज भी मेरे डिस्ट्रिक्ट में है, ऐसा नहीं कि मेरे डिस्ट्रिक्ट में आज कोई ऑफिसर नहीं है, या आज भी मेरे डिस्ट्रिक्ट में कोई तहसीलदार नहीं है, ये तो नहीं, ऐसा नहीं है कि कोई है नहीं. सो द पावर टू क्रिएट चेंज दैट लाइज विद द गवर्नमेंट इज मोस्ट ऑफन ट्रांजैक्शनल एंड ऑफन टाइम्स डज नॉट मेक पीपल एम्पावर्ड इनफ. पीपल आर ऑफन टाइम्स लेफ्ट एज बीइंग बेनिफिशरीज ऑफ स्कीम्स. एंड माइंड यू, इट इज वेरी मच इन द इंटरेस्ट ऑफ पॉलिटिशियंस टू कीप पीपल एज बेनिफिशरीज ऑफ स्कीम्स. क्योंकि अगर आप बहुत ही एम्पावर हो गए तो आप कल आओगे ही नहीं ना मेरे पास. तो आपका मेरे ऊपर का अगर डिपेंडेंसी खत्म हो गया तो फिर मेरा भाव क्या रहेगा? मेरे को वोट आप क्यों देंगे? मेरे पीछे पीछे आप क्यों दौड़ेंगे? तो इट इज इन माय वेस्टेड इंटरेस्ट टू ऑलवेज कीप यू इन सम और द अदर वे डिपेंडेंट ऑन मी. दैट इज हाउ द प्रेजेंट पावर स्ट्रक्चर्स ऑपरेट. एंड आई बिलीव इन शिफ्टिंग द पावर मोर टुवर्ड्स पीपल. And I personally thought that I might have more opportunity to do so, more free hand to do so, if I join the social sector. So I decided to join social sector. But yes, as I said, there is a lot of other good that can be probably accomplished through government. And so if somebody wants to do that, most welcome. Our organization, our parent organization is SEARCH. Which was started in 1986 to work on public health and healthcare issues in tribal Gadchiroli. And Nirman is not a separate organization, it's a separate initiative, it's a separate program under SEARCH. So although we have people from 18 different states of India, and Nirman works primarily with youth empowerment, not so much restricted only to health, but we're not a separate organization. We're still in the umbrella of SEARCH. And one of our partner organizations is MKCL, Maharashtra Knowledge Corporation. So yeah, so why Nirman? So I would say two, three things. One is a question that you started this entire conversation with, that there is a great need of talent and great need of people engaging in social action and social sector. And there aren't many organized processes to make it happen. So we thought that Nirman could be one way by which young minds and bright minds of this country would get exposed to a variety of social challenges and then might decide to contribute either fully or part-time to solving those challenges through various sectors. So we wanted to create a process like that. But we also felt that we are not looking at young people only as agents of external social change. That is definitely something that we want to inspire and motivate and equip them to do so. But our immediate primary attachment and immediate primary outcome is the young person who gets in contact with us. So our primary success indicator is hamare sampark mein, hamare program mein jo bhi young person aata hai, kya wo flourish hua? Kya uski growth hui? Kya uski healthy development hui? That is our first success indicator. And as a natural succession of that, अगर उसकी हेल्थी ग्रोथ हो रही है तो ये हो ही नहीं सकता कि वो सिर्फ अपने आप तक सीमित रखे. उसका नेचुरल एक्सटेंशन ये होना चाहिए दैट ही और शी शुड थिंक दैट व्हाट इज इट दैट आई कैन कंट्रीब्यूट टू अदर्स एंड हाउ कैन आई सॉल्व अदर्स प्रॉब्लम्स. सो द सेकंड थिंग इज व्हाट इज इट दैट ही और शी इज डूइंग टू कंट्रीब्यूट टू सॉल्विंग सोशल चैलेंजेस. सो दीज आर द टू थिंग्स थ्रू द लेंस थ्रू विच वी लुक एट निर्माण. तो ये जो इनिशियल पार्ट है कि हमारे संपर्क में जो भी यंग पर्सन आया उसकी ग्रोथ हुई कि नहीं, तो ये ग्रोथ के कई अलग अलग फैसेट्स हो सकते हैं एंड वी वर्क ऑन अ वैरायटी ऑफ देम. बट वन ऑफ द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट फैसेट ऑफ अ यंग पर्सन ग्रोथ इज दैट यंग पर्सन गेटिंग अ सेंस ऑफ पर्पस. सो हमारे निर्माण का टैगलाइन भी यूथ फॉर पर्पस फॉर लाइफ है. तो ये क्या है भैया, पर्पस फंडा क्या है? तो एक चीज आप देख लीजिए दैट मोस्ट ऑफ आवर कन्वेंशनल एजुकेशन gives us hell lot of information which we are supposed to mug up and go and write about in exams. Occasionally it gives us good skills. Not everybody is lucky enough to be in IIT to get good skills so frequently. Most often agar aap duniya desh ke alag alag colleges dekhoge to skills ke naam pe to kafi problem hi hai. But information bahut milti hai, skills kabhi kabhar milti hai, lekin sense of purpose almost kabhi nahi milta hai. Ye jo main computer engineer ban gaya aur ye jo main कोई एरोस्पेस इंजीनियर बन गया, इस स्किल और इंफॉर्मेशन का मैं क्या करूँ, किसके लिए इसको इस्तेमाल करूँ, ये एक्टिवली ढूंढने की प्रोविजन या प्रोसेस या एटमॉस्फेयर हमें मोस्ट ऑफन नहीं मिलता है. So that question goes unanswered. And then the so-called fashionable answers, which are already prevalent in the market, Semantic join kar lo, Google join kar lo, Apple join kar lo, ye join kar lo, wo join kar lo, as if that is fait accompli, aisa soch ke young log chalte hain. To jisko khushi se wo karna hai, jarur kare. But for those, if they want to figure out a different path, we need to have at least some way of helping them identify what is their purpose. So that is a big vacuum that is lying. The other thing is, the psychological research in the field of purpose has shown that purpose is an intention. Purpose is a strong intention to do something that is meaningful to yourself and is also of consequence to the world beyond self. Now, this is not Amrutban speaking anymore. I am quoting the definition of purpose as given by Professor William Diamond, who is a professor at Stanford University, one of the world's most leading scholars of human development, who articulated purpose like this, that it's a stable and generalized intention to accomplish something which is meaningful to yourself as well as of significance to the world outside. So, ye aisa purpose kaise dhoonde? Ye usually milta nahi hai. And the research has also shown that finding and committing to a purpose in your young age, so maan lo aap 18 se 28 ki umr mein hai, aap youth hai, to is umr mein you finding and committing to a purpose is one of the best predictors of your long term well being. To 45 ya 50 saal ki umr mein aapka khud ka jo future self hoga 50 saal ki umr ka, उसका वेलबींग कैसा होगा, ये अगर आपको आज बैठ के प्रेडिक्ट करना है तो वन ऑफ द स्ट्रॉन्गेस्ट प्रेडिक्टर इज गोइंग टू बी, एंड दिस इज साइंटिफिक रिसर्च, ये वेस्ट में हो चुका है, अनफॉर्चुनेटली हमारे यहाँ अभी तक नहीं हुआ है, लेकिन वेस्ट में हुआ है, वन ऑफ द स्ट्रॉन्गेस्ट प्रेडिक्टर ये है कि क्या आपको आज आपके लिए कोई वर्थवाइल पर्पज मिला है जिसको आप कमिट कर रहे हैं. सो एज आई सेड, पर्पज सीम्स टू बी वन ऑफ दोज मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट फैसेट्स विच इफ it takes place and if young people are able to find it out, that is in their most benefit, and it will also lead them to do something which is of consequence to the larger world. So that's why Nirman has such a strong emphasis on helping young people discover purpose. We unfortunately don't have a rapid process or a bullet by which you can just find it. There is a long process that we are going through to help you discover that. We seem to be doing fairly good. Just in the chat box right now, Yatin has pasted a link, and you can also find it on our website, nirman.mksl.org. So for the first time in India, Nirman has developed a purpose questionnaire. So it's an online questionnaire, takes around 10 to 15 minutes for you to fill up. It asks you various questions related to your purpose, and then gives you a report, a personalized report in your email box, which also gives you a variety of your scores on different dimensions of purpose, and also gives you some steps as to what is it that you can do next. So that is just one small step that some of you who are interested in purpose can go on doing. But my humble request to all of you is, for your own long-term well-being at least, forget the larger society, but for your own long-term, make it a priority to identify and commit to a purpose that you find worthwhile. Yeah, so at least three things. One is, donate at least 1% of your annual salary. You can keep it 1%, 0.5%, you can also make it 10%, that's up to you. But my humble request is, if you are an IITian, you are going to work in corporate sector, most likely you are going to be earning quite big. You'll be earning so much that you are not going to need it in your entire lifetime. So at least 1% of it, if you can donate to social cause regularly, that would be a great help to so many social organizations. You can definitely consider Nirman and search, but I would say go ahead and think about the cause that is really close to your heart. Try and do research, which are some of the most effective organizations trying to work on these causes. And then if you can go and support them, even your money would be put to the best use. So I would say even donating money shouldn't be merely a sentimental decision. Also bring some rigor to that. And whichever cause inspires you, go ahead and see how can you donate to the best people working in it. Part one. Part two, can you volunteer your time? Even if you can't do it full time, at least one weekend a month, 12 hours divided over a month spread across a year, whatever way you want to jumble it. But I think access to bright minds is a big thing. And if you do right amount of volunteering, you can accomplish a lot. Just to give an example, here in Gadchiroli, our parent organization Search has a hospital, and we cater to around 55,000 patients every year in our hospital. It's in this travel belt. We don't have any in-house surgeon. Neither do we have an in-house anesthetist. Still, every year, we do around 600 to 700 surgeries, including spine surgeries, thyroid surgeries, hysterectomy, hydrocele, all sorts of surgeries, kidney surgeries. How is this possible? Because quite a few really eminent surgeons and anesthetists from all across Maharashtra, from the topmost spine surgeon in Bombay to a variety of surgeons across Maharashtra, they regularly volunteer with us. So they have given, there is a proper schedule. Right now it is postponed due to this corona thing, but otherwise there is a proper schedule that every few months there is a camp, there is a surgery camp. So our team here kind of identifies the patients, the doctors come at a regular interval, they do the surgeries, and that's why a poor tribal patient from Gadchiroli has access to a spine surgery at the hands of Dr. Shekhar Bhojraj, whose otherwise client in Bombay would involve the Chief Minister or Amitabh Bachchan. And he comes here every quarter along with his colleagues on a regular fashion and does the spine surgeries. So I'm just saying that regular volunteering, the frequency could value vary, but the regular volunteering can bring in a lot of value. I gave you an example of medicine, but even from an engineering perspective, the kind of skill set that you would develop, the abstract skill set that you would have developed by working in your corporate domain, I think there's a great deal of benefit that the social sector can receive and can reap through using that intellect. So find out an organization which is good, find out a person that you gel with, tell them I'm available this much amount of time. What is it that you want me to do? Even that would be a good thing. So donate, volunteer time. And third thing is, in your daily life, in your weekly life, in your behavior, what is it that you can do by which you can do small acts of kindness, small acts of fairness, small acts of propagating right values? So I would say, don't smoke. Even that's a great act. You not smoking is also saving your own health, saving people around you from that smoke, and also propagating a value in society that smoking is bad. Don't do it. I would say if you are taking your sabji or your fruits from a vendor on the street, please don't bargain. We don't bargain in big malls. Why do we bargain with poor vendors? So even such small things in your daily life can actually also be a way to contribute to social action. And the next thing that I'm going to say is slightly controversial, but the most famous professor of bioethics, Peter Singer, who teaches at Yale and Princeton in Australia, says that turning vegetarian is a great way by which an individual can contribute to curbing carbon emissions. So he tracks your vegetarianism to that, not from a religious perspective, but from a global warming emission perspective. So whether you want to do it or not is a different thing, but just to give an example, the habits that you inculcate in your daily life and the way you interact with the people around you is also a way you can uphold certain important values. So donate, volunteer, follow these things. Three things are good enough. And apart from that, whichever private company or corporate company you are working in, stand for certain ethics. If you think that the company is doing something bad, speak up. If you think they're liberating pollutants in upstream, stand against it. If you think there are being shortcuts related to quality, stand against it. If you think there has been unnecessary profiteering, stand against it. We need quality, we need ethics, and we need excellence even in the private sector. So as a professional, even if you bring that, that would also be a good thing. So if you, for whatever compulsion, if you have to work in the private or corporate sector, don't just say, ab main kuch nahi kar sakta, ab to kaise bhi joo loo chali jayega bhaiya, ab kya karne ka. Please don't do that. Contribute in these micro ways and also stay true to the quality and ethics norms in that sense. So there are a variety of them, and I think I also mentioned quite a few during the course of this talk, right from how can we predict the next farmer or the next student who might be committing suicide. We could also, as I said, we have to think about solar solutions. How can we make dependence on fossil fuel go down? How can eventually we may even go off grid and have decentralized solar solutions available in a variety of remote villages. There is a great and fascinating experiment being done by an organization called Give Directly, which came up with this bold proposal that why have all these indirect rounds and rounds of people and schemes and officers and NGOs and all of that? Can we, for economic benefit, specifically pertaining to that, the Give Directly said, can we directly go for cash transfers, direct benefit transfer or direct cash transfers? And right now, they're running a control trial in Kenya about that. I think it's a fantastic experiment. So some of you who are more financially minded could also think about what is it that we can do related to direct cash transfers in India. Another challenge related to that is, as we spoke sometime during the course of this talk, one of the top placement offers is to get into Goldman Sachs, or whether it is IIT or whether it is Harvard or whether it is Penn or Stanford or whatever else. That's one of the top placement offers where we manage money of the rich and help them become richer. Fine if somebody wants to do it. But then can we also give thought to how do we manage the money of the poor? Actually, if you look at it, there are more ingenious minds required to manage the money of the poor because there is more at stake. The risk appetite has to be lower, but you have to also think about what is it that you can do so that they get better returns on whatever capital, whatever amount of cash that they have. And I don't think there is anybody thinking in these terms. Garib is insan ke paas bhi kuch to paisa hota hai, kuch to asset hote hain, aise pade hain. Kaiyon ke to bank account bhi nahi hai. Bank account hai to usme bas savings account mein 3% ya 2% interest rate mil raha hai. Isse kya hoga? So we apply such a complex thought to come up with financial instruments to make the money of the wealthy much more. Can we create something innovative so that the poor's money gets managed? So that's also just one interesting challenge which I would like to throw. Health is an important topic, and there are so many diagnostics which are there in health, which are usually lots and lots of bulky machines, right from MRI to CT scan, to even this RT-PCR testing that we have for corona. And they are bulky, they are not easily accessible. You have to travel to a district place, sometimes 200 kilometers to get access to these tests. How can we improve health diagnostics? How can we create abilities and devices by which diagnosis can take place at the point, at the village, in the slum, without the patient having to travel so long? So even I would say that's a very, very important challenge to solve. How do you improve learning outcomes of students? हमारी स्कूलों में हमारे कॉलेजेस में इतने लड़कियां हैं पढ़ रहे हैं ऐसा हमें लगता है. एंड यूजुअली व्हेनेवर देयर इज टॉक, द टॉक इज अबाउट कितने टीचर्स दिए हैं, करिकुलम में अभी क्या है, इसमें क्या है, टॉयलेट्स बांधे हैं कि नहीं बांधे हैं, स्केच पेंस मिले कि नहीं है, मिड डे मील मिल रहा है कि नहीं मिल रहा है. फेयर, ऑल गुड, आई एम ऑल फॉर इट. बट इफ यू लुक एट इट, ऑल ऑफ दीज आर इनपुट पैरामीटर्स. We should also be concerned about what are the outcome parameters, especially learning outcomes. So, Bharat ke schoolon mein aur Bharat ke alag alag colleges mein, how to improve learning outcomes, how to even track learning outcomes, and then how to bring about those learning outcomes in the best possible manner. This is also a fantastic challenge. So, I can go on and on, but I would say these are just some of the interesting challenges which fascinate me. And I think if it also fascinates you, yes, go ahead and try and take a crack at it.
Yeah, great, Amrut Dada. Thank you very much.
So before you conclude, let me just say thanks to everyone. And thanks to Pawan and Abhinav for organizing this. Thanks to all the audience for coming and listening and asking really interesting questions. And I'm really happy that instead of this becoming a monologue, which might just come from my own whims and fancies, if at all, it has been directed more so from the questions that you really had in mind. If I have been able to contribute at least a percent to solving some of the questions and maybe raising some new questions, I'm really glad for that. Also, thanks a lot to all the faculty who came in. It was fantastic to see Professor Anand Rao and also Professor Bakul Rao, Narendra Shah, and all of that. And I really hope to meet you all sometime soon physically. And lastly, any of you who is interested in Nirman, the selection process for our next batch is going on right now. The application form is there on our website. And anyone of you who is interested, please go ahead and fill it up.
Okay. So thank you, Amrit sir, for this great. I think it was one of the very insightful talks that we had. And there are many students who have this year joined for the M.Tech program at Cetara. So I think a lot of clear thought of what development sector is and what they can do to, through it is clear to them right now. And so thanks a lot. I thank you on behalf of the Cetara family. And I also thank all the participation that has been through the Zoom meeting and also through the YouTube. So thanks a lot.
Thank you so much.